Artists Speak Out on BCTV is supported by Lucille DiGiamberardino.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Artists Speak Out. And I have a woman here that I have met in a very interesting way, which I'll tell you about later. But she is a pottery artist and also a teacher. Her name is Amy Holland. And please welcome her to this beautiful time together. I'm very excited.
I am too, Lucille.
Thank you so much for coming.
Yeah, thanks for asking me.
What I wanted to start out with is, as you can see also, we have some of her beautiful work here. But tell me a little bit about you and where you come from, what's your ethnicity, what brought you to becoming who you are today? That's a big question.
That is a big question.
So go ahead.
I'm a coal region girl. I was born in Shamokin, Pennsylvania. And that's, when we talk about art, that's gonna play a little bit more in this platter, right? And youngest of four children. So I was able to be creative. I was encouraged to always do art. I got to go to college and I majored in art education at Penn State. But I had an emphasis in sculpture. And then later, many years later, moved to Vermont with my husband, Michael. And there needed to meet some people, so he found a little pottery and said he just encouraged me to take a pottery class at, it's called the Little Red Schoolhouse.
Oh, that's great.
And I took one pottery class. We were young and poor, so we didn't have a lot of money to sign up again. And Susan, who was the potter and the pottery teacher there, she must have seen how much I loved it or seen like we had a connection, because she called me and said, why can't you come back, or would you like to take another class? And I said, well, you know, we really can't afford it. So she said, okay, well, let's barter. And that
was
the first time.
I believe in bartering.
I have ever heard bartering in my life.
Perfect.
Yeah, yeah. So we bartered. I would make her pots for her, and she would teach me. And then she asked me to be her apprentice. So 2 years later, I ended my apprenticeship with her and started taking classes at another craft school in Shelburne, Vermont. And in that place, another potter, Bob Green, encouraged me to start really thinking about teaching. I paid attention more about how to teach pottery, and he started giving me more responsibilities. I worked in the office there. At a craft school, learned how to run a craft school, and then learned how to teach, and then moved to Lititz.
There you go.
Yeah, back to our
family. I want you to show these and talk to us about it. Can we zoom a little bit into it too? Because I met you through a friend who gave me, and you'll see that soon, people, gave me a mug, and the mug was just fit into my hand so beautifully, and the way that it felt, and like I was telling you when you came to my house beforehand, even the way that my hand fit into the handle and the thumb, it just attracted me so much, not just the theme of the mug, but just the way that it felt in my hand. So talk to us about these pieces and tell me how you do this.
Okay. All my work is done on a kick wheel, which zero electricity,
right.
Woman powered. And when you're talking about the handle, I pay really just close attention to how it's gonna feel in your hand. I want someone to every day pick up something I made and feel happy using it.
Right.
I pay attention to how your fingers feel and
right.
where that little thumbprint
right.
is, so that it feels good when you're using it.
Yeah.
So everything is made on a kick wheel, and a lot of what I make has a story behind it. Mm-hmm. Like the strong woman. I don't know if you have the image.
Let's put
there.
Up the image up, the strong woman image, if you don't mind. That's her, that, oh,
yeah,
first of all, before we get to the
house.
Strong woman, that is your studio.
That's my studio.
Now, isn't yeah. that the best place? And now the next one will be the strong woman video. There
right
you go.
There.
Yeah. And that's the mug that I got. So when I felt that, I was actually feeling that exactly as you were describing, this was what you pay attention to when you're making your pottery.
It is.
Go ahead, speak about that.
So the story behind the Strong Woman Lives Here series, I've been making it for almost 11 years now. When I turned 40, one of my close friends, Janet, for my 40th birthday, gave me a rosemary plant, rosemary bush. And she was living in the South, I think North or South Carolina. And she told me one of her close friends growing up, her mother always said to her, when you walk past a house and you see a rosemary bush at that house, you know a strong woman lives there.
There you go.
So Janet was one of the first people to get a plate with, I took a snippet of the rosemary, and you can see I grow rosemary to use
yeah.
all year round. I took a snippet of the rosemary and pressed it into the mug while it was still semi-wet.
Uh-huh.
And I just rub it in with my finger, and then I pull the rosemary out. And then it gets fired once. It's called a bisque fire.
Okay.
And it comes out of the kiln. And I handwrite the wording on each plate. Everything I make, it's handwritten. Everything is...
Yes, and you could feel, I could feel that on the mug. Because
yeah,
I thought that must be a rosemary sprig.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm very much, I love just to touch things. I definitely do. And this is a piece that is fascinating. You said everything has a story.
It does.
So now
yeah.
you were telling me before we went on about what type of pottery this is. So if you can explain to people what that is.
Yeah, so I use a buff stoneware clay. And this clay, it has a grog in it, and grog is like a sand, and it acts like ball bearings in the clay, and it gives it a little bit more flexibility. And I like it, I'm attracted to something that looks like dirt and earth, like my garden from the first image. I love to garden too. So that's where it starts, the type of clay. I've tried other types of clay, and this is the one I gravitate toward the most.
Because of the feel.
Because of the feeling, yeah. So, and when you're throwing with it, you can feel that grog in
mm-hmm.
your hands.
Is it a meditation when you do this?
It's really meditative. It's very therapeutic. If you can get to the point where you're not worried about what you're doing,
mm-hmm.
it's really calming. When I'm teaching pottery, I try to emphasize the process
mm-hmm.
and not the product
right.
as much, so people can just use it as something that's more therapeutic
okay.
and calming and meditative and brings them joy.
I think that's
life.
Wonderful. And so I was touching this. Too bad you can't feel this out there in the audience. But now talk about these two pieces also.
So this, I make urns for humans and for animals. I love animals. So this is just, normally what I would do is if someone wanted an urn for their animal, they would send me a picture. And I believe there's a slide.
Yeah, let's go to the next slides and see what we come up with. That's the first, okay. And if we can go to the next one, then you call it when it's
yeah,
come.
Yeah, I will.
And then the next one. That's your That's your Stations of the Cross.
That's the Stations of the Cross, yeah.
And then what's next?
Yep, more Stations of the Cross that I did for our church.
Mm-hmm. And then?
That's a human urn.
Okay, that's a human urn.
Mm-hmm. Yep, an urn for someone.
Wow.
So the big one is a regular sized urn, and the little one is called a keepsake. It just mimics the big one, and that's in case someone decides they want to keep
some little ashes
for themselves. Yeah.
That's beautiful.
Yep. And those are the different birds that I'll put on top of. Those are three little keepsakes.
Wow. Okay. And what else do we have?
So that's the pet urn.
That's the pet urn.
Mm-hmm. This was my niece's dog, Milo, and I made that for her. And she just sent me pictures. Normally people just send a few pictures so I can get different angles. And I'll make the urn. That one's probably only this big as
well. Oh, wow.
Yeah, okay. He was a little pup. And I'll throw that on the wheel and then sculpt, like I did the cat. I'll sculpt the dog or the cat.
See, that's the thing that's amazing me, too, is because you sculpt images on top of your pottery, too, or near your pottery. And I think that, so that you're actually doing two genres of art. You're doing the pottery and you're also doing sculpting. And what about this about your daughter? Tell them about this one.
So this is a collaboration that I've been doing for quite a few years now with my daughter, Fiona. And she asks me to make her certain shapes. And I'll make the mug or whatever, or the vase that she's interested in making. And she was really into mushrooms. So this is called the Dark Knight series. She colors them and then freehand carves them. So she'll just pick this up while it's still wet.
Okay.
And with a tool, just carve it. And then she, with this one, she hand built a mushroom over the handle.
Well, that is impressive. So she did that.
She did that.
Wow.
Yeah. The only thing I do is I make the mug or whatever she wants me to make, but then she designs it, she does everything else.
So she's got some of mommy's talent.
She has more. More than mommy's talent.
Yeah. Well, they have to start somewhere, and if they live in an environment of artistic exchange, they're going to pick it up. Now, this one is imperative because this is your background.
That is, yes.
And that is the coal regions,
mm-hmm.
right?
That is the coal region.
I don't know if you can get a shot of that. That is so fabulous.
So I grew up with a big Polish influence.
May I lift it?
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
So we can at least see it a little better.
So this is a big platter.
And, there we go.
This technique is called sgraffito, and what you do is the same as Fiona did with this one. I painted the whole center black, and then with a tool went in and hand carved the color away.
So the color away.
Yeah, the black
away. Color in.
And then after I did that, I fired it and then underglazed, which are the bright colors, and mm-hmm. painted. The brighter colors in the back, and then hand wrote the meaning. So this is the cemetery in back of the house where I grew up. That's the soldier's ring, and I walked there and ran there in high school. It's where I would see that from our house. And then this is called the silk mill. That's where my mother worked when I was very little. So that was a big thriving factory. This is a train, and the railroads would actually go right into the mill. And the mill was, we would visit her there during her lunch breaks. And I just remember it feeling like a castle and just feeling like it was something so important.
Well, it's just absolutely gorgeous.
And the
thing is, it tells a story, as all of yours does.
Yep, so, and the quote is actually,
what does
that
it say?
Until the day breaks and the shadows flee away.
Yeah.
And this was in this cemetery. There was a big mausoleum. And this quote was engraved
in
the door for the mausoleum.
Okay.
So, everything from my memory from my childhood.
I think that's beautiful. So, Eileen, thank you for giving me this mug and then leading me to this woman. Okay, that's the thing. So, hello, Eileen, mwah to you. So now, let me ask you this. Now, we talked a little bit about your background. We talked a little bit about your process of how you work. Can you tell the people that would be viewing us, or as I call them, my audience, what brought you to being who you are as a creative artist and sculptor and all of the things that you do? So talk to me about how does that work? Do you ever just say, I don't want to do this anymore, or you say, I love this, I will do this for the rest of my life, forever and ever?
Yeah, I say I want to do it forever and ever for the rest of my life, but with every maker and every person who is attached to what they do, there's always doubt.
Yeah.
There's always doubt, yeah. And it's more self-doubt, and I know you've had other artists talk about, like, that is a big one, but I've just had amazing people encourage me throughout my life and throughout this whole process. My husband, my family, his family, everybody is always so encouraging, and people that I meet, like, when you have doubt, something always happens where someone says something to you, a door opens, and you realize that this is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Well, I think you're right, because as I said, I did not know you. I pursued you, which is what I do. And there we were. Mm-hmm. And then as you were sitting with me having coffee this evening, and we were talking, it felt like we were old friends.
Absolutely.
And I guess, is there a spirit that moves you, or is it, how could people understand, they understand what you do, how can they understand who you are as an artist? Mm.
There's lots of layers to that answer.
I know.
I would think that, or I hope, that when you meet me, you would get the feeling of my art and my work from me.
Right.
So I feel like they're inseparable.
That's right.
I want to give people the feeling, and I want my pots to give the feeling of being in nature, of something natural, of something that's just made from scratch, homemade, and home.
Mm-hmm.
Home is so important.
Comfort.
Yeah. Comfort. Yep. I think that's the most important thing, that I want people to have things in their home of mine that give them joy, that add beauty to their lives,
right.
But also when you pick up that mug, you feel like, okay, wherever this is, I'm home.
That's right. Because I think for your pieces, because they can go into homes, I am not what you are, but what I feel when I received that gift was that I wasn't alone, that it interested me. This was a simple, what most people say, it's a mug, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
But I felt you in the process of touching it.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think that you have a gift, not just because you're very talented, but you have a gift to bring joy to people. Do you feel that way?
You hope it. You hope it.
Yeah.
It's good to hear.
Yeah.
It's good to hear. It's good to, going back to when you are feeling like, why am I doing this? Like, mm-hmm. sometimes I feel like, why am I putting more things into the world? The world doesn't need any more things. But I also want to put things in the world that are made by hands.
Okay.
And I want people to start thinking about what's important more. And I think especially during the pandemic, people are reevaluating or have been reevaluating what's important in their lives.
Yeah.
And since then, I think it's amazing that people are gardening more, people are growing their own food again, creating beauty around their homes, and really, instead of putting off, well, I'll take that pottery class someday, the amount of people who are pursuing art is overwhelming. It's amazing.
It art, is the time.
Music, it's the time. People don't want to wait anymore. People realized, I have to do this for myself or for someone else now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it's time is fleeting.
It's important.
Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely.
You're touching my soul, and I appreciate your honesty, because I would ask you before we close, what gives you joy? Because you definitely give joy. I can verify that you definitely give joy. Okay. So, what gives you joy? Because we need it too, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. When, you know, just something that happens during the day that is nice, kindness, mm-hmm. really gives me joy.
Okay.
When someone just holds the door open for you. My husband's great at that. When just simple, very acts of simple things give me joy.
Acts of simple kindness?
Kindness, yep. Simple acts of kindness give me joy. Knowing I'm going to be able to put my hands in the garden soon, getting dirty, growth, seeing that, enjoying every season gives me joy. Walking through the snowstorm that just happened
yes.
this past weekend
yes.
gives me joy.
Yes.
I think really noticing the little things day to day and reminding myself, look for the beauty in this. Like, don't let this pass.
There we go. And I think that's the whole idea, at least this is what I feel, is that art is beauty. It evolves in whatever form that is. Kindness is definitely needed at this time,
mm-hmm.
and acceptance, and just love.
Mm-hmm.
And I thank you for doing that woman's series, because being who I am as a feminist, it just really gave me the strength to go through a very, very rough time.
Yeah.
And so to actually hold something that gave me a sense of not being too lonely, mm-hmm. but to actually have something to hold. And that is a gift that you give. You give a gift. Would you like to say goodbye to your family or anybody? Or say hello?
Yeah. Hi. Thank you,
everybody.
Because we got
a minute, so you can.
Yeah.
So you have two children.
I do.
Yeah, so
yeah.
If you want to mention them and say hello to them and look in the camera.
Yep.
Do the mom
Mike,
thing.
Fiona, Patrick,
yeah.
My family. Thank you for supporting me and, yeah, for allowing me to be who I am.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, you're
it's
a beautiful
important.
Soul, and I thank you very much for coming. And I hope to be with you more.
Oh, yeah,
you're
definitely.
An inspiration to me, cool. and I like being inspired.
Yeah.
So, again, thank you so much for coming to Artists Speak Out. To get to learn not only just the different types of art that we give you, but also the people behind it. So I wanted to say good night, and I love you very much, and mwah to all of you, and see you again next month.
Artists Speak Out on BCTV is supported by Lucille DiGiamberardino.